Don't think we're getting the audio, the music anymore though now. Okay, it's always interesting to figure this out. And now it's working, it looks like. So we've got audio and we've got the mic. And so we're back up to Philosophy Roulette 12. Welcome all and any people that watch this. Second of the night, we just commented on meriological nihilism, keeping it simple. And let's do something different. I wonder if there's like a sort by popular, get like the ones with like the super high counts. Motor intentions and non-observable knowledge of action. A standard story. Okay, we've not been talking about motion, motor intentions. According to the standard story given by reductive version of the causal theory of action. We haven't done action theory. So, Ole and Chiara. Let's see. Please be here. Nope, not so much. Hey. Oh, this is just a... Is there a download? Or is it... No, this is just the... listing. Boo. Alright. Can't do anything if you don't want to let me see it. The inactive automaton as a computing mechanism. Philosophy of computation might be interesting. But... Now I'm just angry because of the other one. I want to do the other stuff. Let's see if this is here. Come on, people. More grounding. Oh, yeah, more grounding. Behavioral circumscription and the folk psychology of belief. This has got the most number of authors I've ever seen. What? I can't even with that. The numbers count. Number skeptics deny when we face achievement. Saving some innocent people from harm and saving a larger number of different though equally innocent people from a similar suffering similar harm. You ought to save the larger number. Numbers skepticism. Alright, let's see what that is. I mean, it's like numbers and ethics or something. Nope, this is not the same thing. I missed the... the search is just tough because of the title. The perfect bikini body. Can we all really have it? Loving gaze as anti-oppressive beauty ideal. Well, what a title. What a title. Actually, let me... Right, here we go. The perfect bikini body. Can we all really have it? Loving gaze as anti-oppressive beauty ideal. Alright, not gonna read the... let's read the abstract. In this paper, I ask whether there is a defensible philosophical view according to which every body is beautiful. I review two purely aesthetic versions of this claim. The no standards view claim that everybody is maximally and equally beautiful. The multiple standards view encourages us to widen our standards of beauty. I argue that both approaches are problematic. The former fails to be aspirational and empowering, while the latter fails to be sufficiently inclusive. I conclude by presenting a hybrid ethical aesthetic view according to which everybody is beautiful in the sense that everybody can be perceived through a loving gaze, with the exception of evil individuals who are wholly unworthy of love. I show that this view is inclusive, aspirational and empowering, and authentically aesthetical. I mean, it's the old joke. I mean, even Hitler's mom must have liked him. With the exception of evil individuals. Well, I don't know how much we can define evil. As soon as the summer season approaches, but no one's going to the beach this year, it's going to be like COVID-19 everywhere. As soon as the summer season approaches, oh dear, what was that? Is this an ad, or is just this going nuts? Oh, it's just going nuts with the music in the background. As soon as the summer season approaches, the internet is inundated with articles, slideshows such as 37 totally perfect bikini bodies, rule number 1, there are no rules, or 9 stunning bodies that shatter society's stereotypes about the perfect body. These popular articles are ultimately grounded in the feminist imperative of dismantling sexist and oppressive aesthetic norms that harm women in a myriad of ways, among which damaging their self-esteem and affecting their psychological and physical health, exposing them to discrimination in the professional and romantic sphere, and objectifying them and reducing their value to their outward appearance. There are at least 3 different ways of interpreting this feminist imperative. The most extreme, is a form of aesthetic nihilism. Hey, we just were talking about nihilism. Of a very different sort. Which prescribes that we abnegate aesthetic evaluations of each other. According to this view, what we really mean by everyone is beautiful turns out to be, paradoxically, that nobody is. Yes, the, things only matter if it's not universal. While this is a defensible position in the debate about how we ought to aesthetically assess one another's body, it does not seem to be a plausible interpretation of the kind of ideal that is implicitly endorsed in these articles. Here I cannot provide a detailed textual evidence, but I submit that they aim to encourage readers to appreciate some sort of aesthetic value that lies in human bodies. Far from abstaining from judgment, they enthusiastically and vocally present the portrayed women as beautiful. Okay. But a separate and more interesting question is whether aesthetic nihilism is a view worth defending. My answer here is more tentative. Beauty is a fundamental human value, and reserving aesthetic assessment only for objects or animals would entail a gross loss. Don't we want to meaningfully proclaim that our beloved partners or children are beautiful? Furthermore, we are psychologically prone to making these assessments. It is very unlikely that we could ever teach ourselves not to, and I'm wary of ideals that go against our ingrained psychological propensities. Well, I mean, what counts as ingrained there, but okay, fair enough. In this paper, I will focus on 2 other important interpretations of the anti-oppressive imperative that is behind these popular articles. A more radical one, called the no standards view, states that everybody is beautiful, and thus it eliminates appeal to any specific standard of beauty. A more moderate one, call it the multiple standards view, encourages us to widen our standards of beauty. I argue that both approaches are problematic. The no standards view is problematic insofar as it preserves maximal inclusivity at the cost of being insufficiently aspirational and empowering. I argue that beauty is a positional good. If everyone were equally beautiful, we would stop caring about beauty. Yeah. The multiple standards view is problematic for the opposite reason. It preserves the aspirational and empowering character that we want for an ideal, but only for some women, those who qualify as beautiful, thus losing its ethical anti-oppressive impetus. Okay, my solution is that an anti-oppressive ideal of beauty cannot be purely aesthetical, but needs to incorporate some aesthetic ethical elements. I draw from the experience of loving a person. When we love someone, our perceptions change. We see them literally in a different way from other people. When we say that everybody is beautiful, we mean that insofar as everyone is potentially lovable, everybody can be looked at with a loving gaze. The loving gaze view succeeds in differentiating some people from others. The more beautiful we are inside, the more beautiful we appear outside. Okay, well, we'll have to fill that out. At the same time, the discriminating criterion is not based on morally irrelevant and oppressive features. Therefore, the loving gaze view is superior to both the no standards and multiple standards view because it is both inclusive and aspirational while remaining genuinely, if not exclusively, aesthetical. Okay, but what is the loving gaze view? The no standards view. Hold on one sec. I'm just getting a little distracted by the music. Yep, I turned it up because of somebody else. A different stream was a little bit louder and or a little quieter, and now this one's a little louder. Okay. Suppose that we embrace the idea that in order to have a perfect bikini body, you just need to have a body and wear a bikini because everyone is maximally and thus equally beautiful as it is. What kind of aesthetic ideal lies behind this claim? Beer. Beer lies behind it. Beauty lies in the eye of the beer holder. Sherry Irvin has recently proposed a sophisticated articulation of this view, Irvin MS. Irvin starts by reviewing the overwhelming evidence of harm inflicted by conventional standards of beauty to those who fail to satisfy them. She then argues that we have ethical reasons to reject those aesthetic standards and look for alternative ones. She proposes an original model of aesthetic practice she calls aesthetic exploration. In short, aesthetic exploration involves two dispositions, a tendency to approach an object carefully seeking out its aesthetic affordances with the specific intent of finding pleasure in them, and a tendency to do so with a sense of curiosity and adventure, a willingness to encounter and celebrate the unique and surprising, a willingness to tolerate and persist through moments of experience that are jarring. That does sound very nice. Qua practice, aesthetic exploration can be intentionally cultivated and pursued, thus falling under an honorable tradition of exercising indirect control over attitude that may be implicit and thus escape voluntary direct control. Everybody is beautiful, according to Irvin, insofar as living human bodies, all of them do have very rich affordances by virtue of their colors, textures, ever-shifting forms, complex structures, capacities for movement, and so forth. The human body, everybody, is an incredibly replete aesthetic object. Thus, all bodies can afford positive aesthetic experience if approached through an appropriate appreciative practice. Irvin's view is very appealing, and it encourages us to engage in an enriching activity, but can it function as the feminist ideal body that we are looking for? I worry that the very strength of this view in its inclusivity is also its major weakness. According to this view, nobody can fail short of the ideal, providing they are gazed at in the appropriate way. Yeah, it kind of makes everybody into an object to be explored, sort of like a planet. Now, there may be more or less interesting planets, but they're all planets. I mean, so in some sense, it's like if you're always going to explore planets, it's like you've already got it in your head, and it's not the same thing as beauty if you're just doing it on principle. Assume for the time being that this is desirable. Is this view as aspirational and empowering as the ideal we're looking for? I am afraid not. First, insofar the view asserts that everybody is maximally and thus equally beautiful, we lose the aspirational nature of the ideal. This is why I call it the no standards view as opposed to the one maximally met standard view. When everyone meets the standard, there is no need to appeal to it because it does no work of weeding the non-beautiful from the beautiful. Or you could just say the less beautiful. Thus, the standard itself recedes in the background, becoming obsolete or invisible. To see what I mean, consider the following example concerning a standard of conventional beauty. Straight teeth used to be a mark of beauty, but in contemporary U.S. upper middle class, children commonly wear braces even when not medically necessary for purely aesthetic reasons. Really? Who wears braces? They're just like painful. I never did, but like, that seems crazy. Similarly, teeth whitening is increasingly common amongst those who can afford it and is virtually obligatory for actors, politicians, TV hosts, and so forth. In those contexts, having straight white teeth has lost its character for positive aesthetic feature, as something that people get complimented on has become aesthetically unremarkable as having two arms. You see, that seems a little odd, this argument. I mean, they do it because they are trying to look their absolute best, as beautiful as possible. That's why they have to do it on TV. I mean, they don't get complimented on it because it's like dog-eat-dog world. And if they didn't do it, someone who put a little bit more effort into their teeth might get out ahead, just because people do find it aesthetically pleasing to have like white teeth in our society. Anywho, one could object, however, that even though the no standards view fails to discriminate between human bodies, it still succeeds in differentiating human bodies from other objects. Consider a pile of excrement. Barring unusual circumstances, such as an art exhibit, that could count as an objectively ugly thing. Or maybe it could differentiate human beings from non-human beings, such as animals, or possibly aliens. Beauty would then be like Kantian dignity. Every human being, just in virtue of being human, has dignity. Analogously, maybe every human being, in virtue of being embodied, is maximally and equally beautiful, and its positive aesthetic value differentiates human beings qua objects from other non-human objects or beings. While this is a plausible conclusion, it is very unexciting. Everybody is beautiful, not like those tentacled monsters from Venus, and much prettier than a pile of dung. It doesn't quite have the right ring to it. I mean, is that really being fair? Well, maybe. Jokes aside, it's a joke. The view does not provide us with the means to make meaningful aesthetic comparisons between human bodies. As a consequence, it does not provide us with a target we should strive to attain. While it describes something of value, it is epistemically and practically inert. Okay, so basically it becomes the minimal standard and nothing to aspire to or comment upon, really. As unexciting as this ideal sounds, maybe this is what we want, after all. Maybe it is desirable precisely because it's not aspirational, thus removing the need for competition that pits women and sometimes also men one against the other. However, I worry that this view also fails to be empowering. It is a psychological fact of human nature that we care about being beautiful because it sets us apart from others. Yeah, not enough that we succeed, others have to fail. It makes us more appealing than our competitors as sexual and romantic partners or as job candidates, whether beauty is relevant to the job or not. And it renders us worthy of objects of admiration, emulation, and honor. After all, it is these very facts that make the current beauty ideals so harmful to women and men. Those who are perceived as ugly, where that means uglier than others, fare less well on the romantic and sexual market, get fewer jobs and promotions, have lower self-esteem, and so forth. If everybody were all equally beautiful, we would come to care a lot less about beauty. To put it in other terms, body beauty, differently from goods such as dignity, health, or virtue, is a positional good, meaning that its absolute value depends on the possessor's place in the distribution of the good. If we were all beautiful, beauty would not be as valuable. Yeah, sure, it's the one-eyed man is king in the land of the blind. Consider the case of white and straight teeth again. Its aesthetic value among wealthy upper middle class individuals has greatly diminished since it's not a mark of distinction anymore. Yeah, but if you don't have it, it's terrible then. In fact, in recent years, having a small flaw in the context of overall nice teeth, such as a gap between upper incisors or mildly broken tooth, has come to be considered a sign of beauty and sexiness, and it seems plausible to me that it is because those quirks, minor imperfections, break the boredom of perfect teeth in a sea of equally perfect teeth. Yeah, there's a difference between a minor imperfection that is, not indicative of some sort of deeper problem, and then, like, actually having, like, rotting teeth, which is, much worse, but would definitely indicate some sort of bigger problem. Although the breaking, the boredom and, consistency is a point. They always made the, point about, supermodel with the mole right there. Call me. One way to counteract the loss of positionality connected to the no standards view is to reject the idea that everybody is beautiful implies that everybody is maximally, thus equally beautiful. That is, one could claim that everybody has some beauty, but it is still possible to rank people among according to degree of beauty. However, this less radical variant of the view is unstable. In order to clarify how we can differentiate between beauty and between beautiful and more beautiful, we either resort to conventional standards, which are already deemed problematic, or the collapse view into the multiple standards view, which I consider next. To conclude, the no standards view, when interpreted to mean that everybody is maximally and equally beautiful, cannot function as the aspirational, empowering ideal that we were looking for, notwithstanding its rhetorical efficacy. Multiple standards view. Should we then endorse the multiple standards view? At first, it might seem that this is what the supporters of the no standards view aimed at all along. What they ultimately care about is that women stop trying to conform to the standards that are excessively narrow and often impossible to attain, and shaped by oppressive, demeaning norms. But once we start looking for more inclusive standards, another worry arises. Where do we draw the line between beautiful and non-beautiful? Let's analyze a few options, starting with size, which is one of the most important issues in the feminist debate. Someone might argue that while fat women are beautiful, very obese ones are not. But we have evidence showing that obese people are greatly harmed by conventional ideals of beauty that deem them disgusting, and they are discriminated against in many other settings. Therefore, we have ethical reasons to resist suggesting that obese people are ugly just in virtue of their obesity. One could appeal to health reasons. Some bodies are ugly because they are unhealthy, abnormal. Irvin has a convincing response to this suggestion. First, why would we want to socially penalize someone who suffers from a health condition, which is likely to already be distressful to them? Second, observers are not in a good position to know the underlying health condition of someone else's body. Yeah. My knee hurts. There is a further problem with this line of thought. It relies on the conception of normality and the health that are problematic according to anti-ableist or disability positive perspective. Such a perspective denies that disability is intrinsically bad for the disabled person. Without endorsing the notion that disability is intrinsically good for a person, it is often committed to the claims such as the following. Disability is analogous to features like sexuality, gender, ethnicity, and race. Disability is not a defect or a departure from normal functioning. Disability is a valuable part of human diversity that should be celebrated and preserved. A principal source of the bad effects of disability is society's treatment of disabled people rather than the disability itself. Within this framework, we find the idea that disabled, thus conventionally unhealthy and dysfunctional bodies, can be in fact have been thought throughout the history of art sources of beauty. In Tobin Sieber's words, disability aesthetic prizes physical and mental differences as significant value in itself. It does not embrace an aesthetic taste that defines harmony, bodily integrity, and health as standards of beauty, nor does it support the aversion to disability required by traditional concepts of human or social perfection. Rather, it drives forward the appreciation of disability found throughout modern avant-garde art by raising an objection to aesthetic standards and tastes that exclude people with disabilities. The disability aesthetics perspective may be the most formidable opponent to the multiple standards view, making it impossible to draw a line by using any traditional standards of bodily beauty, such as proportionality of limbs, symmetry, and so forth. Sieber's himself would not seem to endorse a view such that everything is beautiful, since he discusses, for instance, examples of kitsch or bad art. There's definitely bad art. But notwithstanding his emphasis on the ineluctable materiality and bodily nature of artworks, he only discusses works of art and does not articulate a view about beauty of bodies, disabled or able-bodied. One final possibility would be to draw the line in some unusual place where it has not been drawn before. Maybe an ugly person is a person who is too perfect, like those portrayed in the Nazi painting Sievers discussed as examples of kitschy art. But a person who is naturally too perfect is not at fault for being that way, precisely like those who have many imperfections. Furthermore, it might be too counterintuitive for a theory of beauty to imply that those who are extremely beautiful by conventional standards are in fact ugly just by virtue of adhering to those conventional standards of beauty. Yeah, that'd be weird. By adhering to the standards, you have failed the standards. That would be kind of strange. Maybe someone who has subjected himself to too many cosmetic surgeries and has become grotesquely artificial could count as ugly. But this proposal also stigmatizes people unjustly. Those who undergo many cosmetic surgeries do so under cultural and societal pressure, which in turn depends on those very oppressive norms we started with. If they end up grotesque with a grotesque appearance, then why would we want to penalize them further? The multiple standards view then fails at being sufficiently inclusive and thus falls short on its ethical motivations. In order to find satisfying ideal body beauty, we have to look outside the purely aesthetic domain. Yeah, this is a fair point here. Like, people do a lot of stuff for a lot of different reasons, and if you disagree with those reasons, fine, but if you think they then have got themselves into a worse position, then you're double criticizing them. And why bother double criticizing them? You're like criticizing society and them for it. That's not nice. A loving gaze as an ethical ideal of beauty. We often talk of internal beauty, of being beautiful on the inside. You know, like, if you look at the inside of the human body, it's very wet. It's like blood and stuff. This notion of beauty is metaphorical, but But there's a non-metaphorical way in which what is inside a person, her character, her spiritual and intellectual qualities affect her outside. It affects the way people perceive her. There's a great quote by Roald Dahl. It says, if you're ugly, it doesn't matter, but if you have good thoughts, you will shine beautifully, or whatever. Yeah, everyone should go look that one up. This is especially evident in loving relationships. Imagine someone who is disgusted by fat people even though she rationally rejects her disposition, just in denial of it. Suppose she happens to befriend an obese person, her loving relationship will affect not only her emotional response to the person, but her perceptions as well. Let's see, that's an interesting claim. It says that the relationship will affect how she sees. Okay. Well, still seeing her as fat, she will cease being disgusted by her and instead comes to see her as beautiful, or at least not ugly. Or imagine someone slowly reciprocating the love of a person previously assessed as unsightly, won over by that person's internal beauty. Yennefer Vandenberg? Moved by her attraction, she will discover valuable aesthetic features of the beloved, and at some point she will look at her or him and see beauty. Her perceptions have changed, and to some extent that change may be permanent. Some luster may go away as the love fades, if it does, but she will never look at that person she used to look at them before loving them. Or think about how we see our children, siblings, and parents. Our affection makes us go beyond their aging, physical flaws, their imperfections. Every loving parent sees their infant as the most perfect creature on earth, even when bystanders secretly beg to differ. My grandma would always say, when someone said, I haven't shown you pictures of my kid, and she would always say, and don't think it's not appreciated. And the other one, of course, is if you don't want to say the kid's good looking, say, oh, it looks just like you. What a darling. An attractive interpretation of everyone is beautiful, then, is not a purely aesthetic one in the modern sense, but a hybrid aesthetic-ethical one. What I have in mind is what the ancient Greeks would refer to as kalos kagathos. This approach rejects a neat distinction between ethical and the aesthetic that is is commonplace in modern philosophy. The particularly ethical element that I want to incorporate is that of loving gaze. We say that everybody is beautiful, we mean that anybody can be an appropriate object of a loving gaze. According to what I call the loving gaze view, the most beautiful individuals are the most lovable ones, independently of what they look like from the outside. Some not-so-lovable individuals will retain some degree of beauty because they are still appropriate objects of love from the perspective of some people, for instance, their mothers. Yes, that's what I said. What about Hitler? But will not be very beautiful, even if they look good from the perspective of conventional standards. So this is there's someone for everyone view. And insofar as you can be the object of their loving gaze, then there is still, you're still beautiful in that person's eyes. Finally, others may be so undeserving of love that those who can look inside them will see them as utterly ugly. For example, by Patrick Bateman. Yes, for example, consider Patrick Bateman, the protagonist of the novel American Psycho by Bret Easton Ellis. Bateman is portrayed as an evil psychopath who deceives, murders, and tortures his victims in the most sadistic ways. His outward handsomeness, which is featured intentionally highlighted by Easton Ellis, makes him no less aesthetically repellent, if anything more, in the same way in which the perfection depicted in Nazi paintings look to the knowledgeable viewer not just kitschy but horrifying. Yeah, it's sort of like making him the perfect killer because everyone wants to. He looks so good, he has all the money and power, and but he just pulls you into his craziness. The loving gaze then retains positionality without losing its ethical impetus. Some individuals are more beautiful than others, but the hierarchy is not determined by morally irrelevant or worse unethical features. Those who are most beautiful on the inside are also the most beautiful on the outside. Wait, how? No, how is it on beautiful on the inside? You are the most potentially beautiful, most potentially lovable, but not most beautiful on the outside. See, we've got some ambiguity around what's inside outside here, and the metaphors are getting crossed. At this point, one might worry I'm changing the subject. And there's something like sheer non-ethical beauty. Fully addressing this worry would require me to tackle the much broader and fervently debated issue of the relation between ethics and aesthetics, which goes beyond the scope of this paper. Clearly, my view belongs to the tradition of aesthetic moralism, according to which an object's aesthetic value is directly connected with its ethical value. Yeah. But, however, there are a few ways in which my views differ from many views that belong to that tradition. First of all, the loving gaze view has a subjective streak due to its relation to the particularism that unavoidably stems from our loving relations. Yeah, it's always a gaze of somebody. Assessing a human body as beautiful need not be a universal disinterested judgment. At the same time, insofar as thoroughly evil people a la American Psycho, if they really exist, are not worthy of personal love, they are also objectively ugly. Hence, judgments of physical beauty are not completely subjective either. Yeah. Well, it's like you have a picture of Christian Bale as the American Psycho, and it's like, well, it's still Christian Bale. Anywho. Second, and perhaps more importantly, even though the view is not exclusive aesthetical, it is irreducibly and authentically aesthetical. In order to be assessed as beautiful, as opposed to just good, the object of the loving gaze necessarily requires embodiment. When we love a person, we come to appreciate features of their body, not just their mind, that we might have appreciated or not appreciated or noticed otherwise. Therefore, the loving gaze is not at all metaphorical. It is the real gaze of an actual person whose perceptions are forever altered by the act of loving and who sees the beloved body as beautiful. Well, it's not at all metaphorical. It's not, I'd just go with it's not entirely, it's only partially metaphorical at all. I mean, there is a actual physical change that's going on in the way they see, or there is some embodied difference in the gaze of the person who loves somebody else and sees them as beautiful. But I mean, where exactly the lines are drawn is not so clear. Patrick Bateman notes, however, that none of the above implies that someone like Patrick Bateman is ugly in every possible sense. He's still handsome by conventional standards of attractiveness. In general, it is perfectly coherent to say that someone is conventionally attractive, but not really a beautiful person, whereas beautiful people, where beautiful is meant to convey an aesthetic ethical judgment. Kalos Kagathos. Of course, with most people, there is not going to be much of an extreme gap between their conventional beauty and their beauty in this anti-oppressive sense, as is the case with fictional evil psychopaths. Finally, the loving gaze is not a view about how, in fact, we aesthetically appreciate everybody. Personal preferences may still be at play, as they are in our loving relationships. That everybody is beautiful does not mean that every particular individual will actually see everyone else as beautiful. This is a view about who can be objectively assessed as beautiful. The answer is almost anyone. Okay. And that's it. Okay. Interesting paper. This bit about this embodiment and how you actually see something different, like the phenomenology is changing, that's an interesting claim. I'd like to hear bunch more about that, that how phenomenological changes occur when in the loving gaze. Because that seems what's going on here. It's not at all metaphorical. It's an actual phenomenological change when you are gazing at the beloved and see them as beautiful. So what's the... You need to talk about the phenomenology of beauty and how that is embodied by people and exists in this sort of interaction between how someone is perceived. Now, that'd be cool. So this is, in some sense, the perfect bikini body is a... Yeah. So this would be a first step in that direction, and I think that's a good thing. There is a bigger problem, of course, than, like, how do you... I mean, if we can modify phenomenology in that way, or should we, or is it only through things like beauty that it gets modified, or things like love does it get modified? So those would all be sort of interesting stuff, but, this is not a bad... So, I wouldn't really say that this paper... I mean, it presents a thesis about how the loving gaze goes, but I'm not entirely certain on what the loving gaze is. I mean, I think it's a sort of phenomenological modification, and since everybody could cause someone else to have some sort of phenomenological modification to see them as beautiful, to interact with them as beautiful, except for like a Patrick Bateman, who would just be horrifying once you interact with him or understand what's going on. That's the real fundamental of beauty. It's how you can modify someone else's understanding and their phenomenology of beauty. And that's fair enough. Okay, so thanks again for watching if you did, and leave me a suggestion if you want me to review something. Have a good day, stay safe, folks.